everyone, and welcome to Thorough Newspaper Analysis, which is presented to you by LawSeekho. So today we will be discussing two articles. Both are from the Indian Express. The first article is titled as Quran Case and the Powers of Judicial Review. This article discusses as to if any person wants any particular verse or any part of the Quran or any such religious scripture to be deleted, does it fall under the power of judicial review of the court or not? And the second article, which is Time to Make the Water Switch, talks about the consumption of freshwater resources in the agriculture of India and how can we make it more resilient and also can make it more sustainable in the coming future. Before we move further, let's have a look at the Project Maverick. So if you're preparing for CLAT 2021 or 2022, you can enroll yourself for this almost free course at LawSeekho, which only will cost you rupees 100. You can check out this course and the link is there in the description box below. With this, let's see what is the multiple choice question from our last discussion. NCLAT stands for, your options are National COVID Labs and Testing Agency, National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, National Company Law Tribunal, or none of the above. You can write down your answer in the comment section below. This is the descriptive question for the day. Does banning of religious scriptures like Quran fall under the purview of Article 25 and judicial review? Also, you can join our daily quiz from the Hindu newspaper live at LawSeekho CLAT prep channel. The link to this channel is also there in the description box below. We come live at every morning 9 a.m. With this, let's start the discussion for the first article for the day, which talks about the PIL in Supreme Court against the verses of Quran. So recently, a PIL, that is the public interest litigation, has been filed in Supreme Court by Wasim Rizvi seeking declaration of 26 verses of Quran as unconstitutional, non-effective and non-functional on the ground as these promote extremism and terrorism and pose threat to the sovereignty, unity and integrity of the country. But the question that we as lawyers or the if we talk about the law in particular that we need to consider here is that, yes, of course, maybe a PIL can be filed against such verses of Quran or any other religious scripture or holy book. But does the Supreme Court or do the courts in our country really have the power to consider such things under the purview of its judicial review or not? So if we talk about the power of judicial review, then only a law that is defined as, you know, as such under Article 13, Clause 3 can be challenged as unconstitutional. Now, as we know that Article 13 of the Indian Constitution talks about the power of judicial review, wherein Article 13, Clause 1 talks about the pre-constitutional laws, as in the laws which were brought in before the Constitution was brought in the country. Article 13, Clause 2 talks about the post-constitutional laws, and Article 13, Clause 3 explains as to what do we mean by the term law. So there are a lot of things that are included under law. Like, for example, there are various executive delegations that are there, laws made by the parliament, laws made by the state legislature, and even some kinds of customs as well. But as we know that even the amendment are not considered to be as a law under the meaning of a law under Article 13, Clause 3 of the Constitution. And that is why it also says that the definition does not include any religious scripture, including the Quran. So if at all we understand it by the purview or by the power of judicial review, so only the terms or only the things that are considered law under 13, Clause 3 can be brought under the purview of judicial review, and thus such religious scriptures like Quran do not fall under the meaning of law, and thus are not subjected to judicial review under Article 13 of the Indian Constitution. Also, the words of divine characters are not customs. Now, as we know that customs and bylaws, etc., are also considered to be as law under the meaning of law under Article 13, Clause 3. But still, the divine characters which are enumerated in such holy scriptures are not considered to be customs and hence are not considered to be law and thus not included under judicial review. So Quran itself had abrogated several shameful customs of Arabs, such as female infanticide. So even Quran had actually fought against such things, and thus it itself is not a custom in its whole sense. Also, the freedom of religion under Article 25 is subject to public order, health, morality, and other fundamental rights. So also we should understand that here freedom of religion definitely is a fundamental right. But if at all we would want to touch or move anything with such religious scriptures, it would itself infringe the freedom of religion under Article 25. So if you talk about the PILs and petitioners in this direction, so PILs became popular post-emergency when the Supreme Court was suffering from crisis of legitimacy due to pro-government decisions. Now, as we know that at the time of 1975, wherein the national emergency was proclaimed in the country, due to the absolute power which was held by the then ruling party or the government, it was Congress, so all the power had moved towards the pro-government, which means that all the decisions of the Supreme Court also were mostly coming in the favor of the government itself. And if at all they were not, so the justices or the judges were also criticized by the government. Now, in such a scenario, the PILs became a popular option wherein the people who thought that the government is not doing something that is right or the courts need to pay more attention towards the social or other issues. So such public interest litigations were more rampantly filed at that time. Then it was also brought to prevent abuse of the PILs. The case of Narmada Bachao Andolan, which was there in the year 2000, said that PIL should not be allowed to degenerate to become publicly interest litigation, publicity interest litigation, or private inquisitiveness litigation. So as we know that the full form of PIL is public interest litigation, wherein if at all there is something that is for the interest of the public at large, so that can be sought in the court of law. But it should definitely not be degenerated or degraded to become a publicity interest litigation, wherein a real purpose of the society at large is not being solved, rather it is only being done for the publicity alone. Or it should not even become for private inquisitiveness litigation as well, wherein I, let's say for example, I being an individual have a question, or I need to ask something or need to bring something in front of the government, but that does not solve anything for the public at large. So that would only suffice to be a private inquisitiveness rather than a public interest litigation. So the court looks into the credentials and motives of the petitioner as well, and only then a PIL is finally entertained in the court of law. And also in the case of Ashok Kumar in 2003, it was held that no petition can be allowed to indulge in wild allegations about the characters of others, and only if at all there is a petition that really, in the real sense, seeks to bring any kind of benefits to the public at large, only that can be entertained under the purview of public interest litigation. Also, if you try to understand that what were the earlier petitions on Quran, so in 1958, that the Supreme Court in the case of Veera Bandaran Chettiar had held that Quran was an object held sacred by Muslims within the meaning of Section 295 of the Indian Penal Code, and it fell beyond the purview of the offense of blasphemy under Section 295A of the IPC. So basically, Section 295A of the Indian Penal Code reads as whoever destroys, damages, or defiles any place of worship or any object held sacred by any class of persons with the intentions of thereby insulting the religion of any class of persons, or with the knowledge that any class of persons is likely to consider such destruction, damage, or defilement as an insult to their religion, shall be punishable with an imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 2 years or fine or with both. So that considerably is the offense of blasphemy under the Indian Penal Code, and thus it says that Quran is an object which is held sacred by the Muslims, and thus it falls under the meaning of Section 295, and thus anything that is done to provide any kind of insult to Quran or any such religious inscription would be considered to be an offense of blasphemy under Section 295 of Indian Penal Code. And then in 1985, in the case of Chandamal Chopra's PIL for ban on Quran in Calcutta High Court, as it allegedly incites violence and promotes enmity amongst different sections, was again disallowed. So it said that banning the Quran would violate Article 25, that is freedom of religion, and the preamble of the Constitution as well, which provides for secularism. And thus, the court cannot sit in judgment on holy books like Quran, Bible, Gita, and Guru Granth Sahib. So the petitioner, by filing this petition, has promoted disharmony and feelings of enmity between different communities, and this definitely is blasphemy under Section 295A. With this, let's discuss the second article for the day, which talks about Catch the Rain. So on World Water Day, that was on 22nd March, Prime Minister of India has launched the Catch the Rain campaign under the government's flagship program under the Jal Shakti Abhiyan. Now, as the name itself is suggesting, Catch the Rain itself is meaning that, as we know, that rain is one of the purest resources of water, and catching the rain, by meaning of catching the rain, we would mean that we should conserve the water that we are having as freshwater resources. So if we specifically talk about the agriculture and water, agriculture in India uses about 78% of country's freshwater resources. And the majority of it, that is 60% of it, is consumed by crops like rice and sugarcane. And only half of the India's cropped area is irrigated, which means that if we talk about the grounds, then 64% of the water is, the resources are provided by groundwater, 23% by canals, 2% by tanks, and 11% by other sources. So here, the overexploitation of the groundwater has made the region amongst the three highest water risk hotspots, with northeastern China and southwest USA. Now, as we know that in India as well, the resources for fresh water have been declining day by day due to the overexploitation. Now, be it the canals, the rivers, or even if we talk about the groundwater recharge as well. So that is why it is of utmost importance that we try to conserve the water which we receive through our rains in the monsoon season. So if we talk about the canals, so 1,591 blocks in 256 districts and in India are critical. So that is one thing that we need really need to be concerned about. And if we talk about the state or the situation of our water resources, so according to the Central Water Commission, India receives mean annual rain of about 3,880 billion cubic meters, and only out of this, 699 billion cubic meters is utilized, and rest is lost to evaporation and other factors. Thus, we should enhance more and more techniques and proper mechanisms through which we can conserve more and more of water which we receive through our annual rainfall. Also, according to the United Nations report on Sustainable Development Goal number 6, which primarily talks about clean water and sanitation, India achieved only 56.6% as per 2019 of the target to provide clean water and sanitation for all by 2030. Thus, India needs to buckle up in this direction as well. Also, according to Niti Aayog's Composite Water Management Index of 2019, 7.5% households do not have access to drinking water. So can you understand that for us, when we sit in our houses, in our homes, it is so easy and comfortable to just go and fetch water for ourselves for drinking purposes. But still, 7.5% of the households in our country do not have the access to drinking water. And India ranks 128th out of 122 countries in water quality index. So can you understand that out of 122 countries, we are 120 in the position. So it is really, really very serious, and we should really be concerned about it. India is identified as the water stressed country in the world. So here, there are some technologies and water conservation techniques that have been suggested in the article. The first one is the drip irrigation. So only 842 liters of water is required to produce 1 kg of paddy, as compared to 3,065 liters under traditional flood irrigation. So can you see that originally, in the conventional manner, approximately 3,000 liters of water is used to irrigate 1 kg of paddy. But here, if we use drip irrigation, only 842 liters of water can suffice. Then also we have direct seeded rice and the system of rice intensification methods, which saves up to 25-30% of water as compared to the traditional flood irrigation method. And then finally, we have the Pani Bachao Paise Kamao by Punjab government initiative, in which it is in association with the World Bank and JPAL. And it encourages rational use of water among farmers, and also has a certain amount of directly transferred to the farmers who save water or power as well. So these things or these mechanisms or techniques should be used, as it is the need of the hour to conserve the water and to make very wise and sustainable use of the water resources. So this was all for the day. We hope it was a good session for you. Thank you so much for staying tuned with Law Seekho.